questions.
The next topic that, as I mentioned in the last one, that we'll be discussing about the errors and accuracy. So whenever we are trying to use any physical method, whenever we are trying to understand how to measure any particular thing, there is a limit to accuracy. Obviously, you cannot get completely accurate result even if you are trying to use the same apparatus, same system of way of measuring the things and everything remaining the same. Even then, all the observations are not going to be the same. There is going to be some discrepancy. Yeah. So, what exactly are we going to understand this? The first thing you understand is that no measurement is perfectly accurate. Okay, this is the first thing. You cannot have any measurement which is completely accurate. There is going to be some amount of error. So there are some amounts of errors that are introduced. So what are the errors? The first one is a random error. Then the other one is known as a systematic error. So if I say that we have first one, a type of error, it's known as a random error. The next one is a systematic error. As the name itself suggests, when you are trying to measure some things, supposing you are trying to measure a pendulum, you are trying to measure the time period of a simple pendulum using a bulb, and it so happens that there is some wind that starts blowing. Obviously, the pendulum will start moving on for a faster time, and therefore the time period that you will get is not going to be the same. Or you are using stop clock and the battery of that stop clock starts going down. So in that case as well, you obviously will not be able to predict whether the value that you are going to get is a correct value or not. So that's a kind of a random error. Similarly, what we have in a systematic error, in the case of a systematic error, in case, let's say you are trying to measure the length and you are trying to see to which extent it is actually matching. Let's say it may be happening that you are using a measurement scale and the length is coming in between two divisions. So the way you measure it, let's say if you try to tilt your head to the left or you try to tilt your head to the right, the results are going to be coming out to be completely different. Though the amount of result difference is going to be minimal, but there is going to be a difference. But the best way to look at it is from the top. Not from left, not from right, actually from the top, right? So there, that's a kind of a systematic error. So systematic errors come up when there is a flaw in the measurement. When there is a way that the way you are trying to measure the things, there is a flaw in that. That is what is known as a systematic error. Okay? So you cannot really control what's a random error, but you can control what's a systematic error. Now, to understand it in a much more error language, so with regard to an error, as to how much is the error that has cropped up, there are a couple of formulae. So we'll try to understand about that. So that is what is known as the errors, or to calculate the errors. So the way to do that is this. For instance, we know that the time period of measurement is given by 2 pi root over L over G. Okay? So if I say T equals to 2 pi root over L by G, now if I want to find out how much is the variation in time period that takes place, if there is a particular variation in length or if there is a particular variation in that expression to do that. Okay? So how to do that? How to do that? To understand, I'm just going to write down formula here. Just take note of that. This is known as differentiation. So d by dx of x raised to the power n, this is going to be given by n into x raised to the power n minus 1. I'll be utilizing this particular formula here, though in a slightly different way, but just take a note of it. Yeah? So, if I say that t equals to 2 pi root over l by t, can I say that this expression can be written as 2 pi n raised to the power half g raised to the power minus half? Right? Now, what I will try to do, I'll try to vary t. Let me remove this factor. Hopefully, we have taken a note of it. So, if I remove this particular factor, so I want to vary t. So, delta t is. So, delta t. So, first I'm going to vary the length. I'm going to utilize the differentiation formula that I mentioned. So, first I'm going to vary the length, keep g constant. Then I'm going to vary g, keep l constant. So, delta t is going to be given by 2 pi. That can be taken off. If I differentiate this, the power of it is going to come down. And the power of this is going to go by down by a factor of 1. Okay? But here we did not have any other factor, we just varied it. So obviously the variation factor also has to be written. So this has to be written as delta L. G dash to power minus half has to be kept as it is. Right? Then now if I vary this, so I'll get minus half. G raised to the power is going to come out to minus 3 by 2. Then I'll get delta G and you'll get L raised to the power half. So this is what I will get. Right? Now let me do it further. So what I will get as a result? I have this. So let me rewrite this particular factor again. So delta t is going to be given by 2 pi. 2 pi I will keep it outside as it is. Here I can write this as half l raised to the power minus half delta l g raised to the power minus half, and then I have minus half l raised to the power half delta g g raised to the power minus 3 by 2. So this is what we have, right? This is slightly complex way to do it. That's the reason I'm not the way to do it is a complex formula. So for this one, what will we get? We'll get 2 pi. Now here, what I want to do, I want to find out delta t over t. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to divide the complete expression by a factor of t. As a result, I'll get half l raised to the power minus half delta l g raised to the power minus half. If I divide this by the factor l raised to the power half g raised to the power minus half, and obviously I'll be dividing by 2 pi as well, right? And the second term, so this is going to be given by minus half. Here I'll get l raised to the power half delta g g raised to the power minus 3 by 2 whole divided by what? This is going to be l raised to the power half g raised to the power minus half. Yeah? So if you try to simplify this, you'll see that this can simply be given by, I can get rid of these factors, right? Similarly, I can get rid of these factors. Here, I can get rid of these factors. So what I'm left with? I'll be left with a factor of half, which I can take it out. Then, I'll get delta L divided by L, because if I take this power to the denominator, I'll get L. Similarly, here I'll get minus delta g divided by g. On the left hand side, I'll get delta t divided by g. Okay? So, now what you have to do, you will be given the variation in length. If there is a variation in the acceleration due to gravity, that will be given to you. The original length, obviously, it should be known. The original acceleration due to gravity, you already know. And the original time needed. So once you know about this, so this will give you a percentage error. If you want to find out the absolute error, that is the value of delta t. Just take the t factor to the right, multiply it, that's going to give you the absolute error. If you want to find out the percentage error, so you just need to multiply by 100 on both sides, that's going to give you the percentage error, or the percentage change. Yeah? So once you know about this, once you know about this particular value, then this is the variation. Now once you know about it, then what you do, obviously you will be doing this for a couple of values, right? Or using that particular apparatus itself. So if you do that experiment with the same apparatus multiple times, then you will get a couple of values of delta t, right? So either, so there is going to be a value of delta t that's going to come out in the form of a range. So effectively what you will say, the actual result of time period, let's say if you are trying to find out, so actual is going to be t, which is the average value of time period that you are going to get, plus minus a delta t. So this is known as the accuracy. So this particular part tells you about the accuracy. This gives you the actual value of the predicted value, of the predicted answers, right? So this is how you find out the actual values of the errors and then the accuracy of the errors. Yeah, hopefully this was clear. See you soon. Goodbye.